Welcome to Kingdom Compliance with Dr. James Bruton, offering biblical guidelines, principles of the Kingdom of Heaven that will help you stay tuned in to the frequency of heaven and reap the benefits that accompany you as a citizen of the Kingdom. The best the King has to offer. Today's topic is Kingdom Authority within your sphere of assignment. I sense strongly that the body of Christ has entered a season of kingdom authority within its assigned spheres. As the basis of what I'm sensing, there are boundaries set by God for every individual assignment, so we would be wise to recognize our own, especially in the season. In Acts chapter 17, verse 26, Apostle Paul said to the Athenians, "And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings." Religion teaches that, if you're saved, you have an obligation to meet all people's needs. But that is just rhetoric. Many good believers have veered off course trying to do all things for all people. Our divine assignment is to specific people in specific geographical locations. Listen to what Apostle Paul says about this in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 10 through 18. "For his letters, they say, are weighty and powerful, but his bodily presence is weak and his speech contemptible. Let such a person consider this, that what we are in word by letters when we are absent, such we will also be indeed when we are present. For we dare not class ourselves or compare ourselves with those who commend themselves, but they, measuring themselves by themselves and comparing themselves among themselves, are not wise. We, however, will not boast beyond measure, but within the limits of the sphere which God appointed us, a sphere which especially includes you. For we are not overextending ourselves as though our authority did not extend to you, for it was to you that we came with the gospel of Christ. Not boasting of things beyond measure, that is, in other men's labors, but having hope that as your faith is increased, we shall be greatly enlarged by you in our sphere, to preach the gospel in the regions beyond you, and not to boast in another man's sphere of accomplishment. But he who glories, let him glory in the Lord, for not he who commends himself is approved, but whom the Lord commends." In this passage, Paul speaks of the measure of God-given authority in Corinth. That's his God-given authority, and also references spheres of authority. The word used for measure is metron, which is a measure, a meter, a limited portion, or a degree. You can easily see the English word meter in this word, which is a measurement or an instrument used to measure, such as a parking meter. It is also used in the context of metering out or measured portion of something. In this context, Paul was speaking of the authority metered out to him, the measure he had been given by God at Corinth. Let's take a look at this word sphere, because sphere is from the Greek word canon, which means a sphere of rule or activity, a standard of faith and practice, a boundary. Paul recognized not only his measure of authority, but also the places where he had been assigned this authority. He knew there were boundaries or limits to it, but he also was very aware that he absolutely did possess God-given authority in his God-given spheres. So the above passage was referring or referencing Paul's authority to deal with error and rebellion as an apostle and father in the Corinthian church. However, it also included authority to war over them in the spirit realm, breaking strongholds and demonic influences. This is clear from the verses of scripture preceding the one we just read. Let's take a look at that. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 through 6. "Now I, Paul, myself, am pleading with you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ, who in presence am lowly among you, but being absent am bold toward you. But I beg you that when I am present, I may not be bold with that confidence by which I intend to be bold against some, who think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ, and being ready to punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. These verses make clear the assertion that Paul's authority at Corinth was not only a right to correct them practically and doctrinally, but also included authority to deal with spiritual strongholds in the community through prayer and spiritual warfare. The principle at play here is that, number one, God gives us authority within the sphere He has assigned us. Our authority level will be different in other spheres. And number two, this authority not only gives us the spiritual right to bring correction, it also affords us great authority to pray and war spiritually for the freedom and well-being of those within this sphere. In other words, most saints would not be given apostolic authority over a region or even a nation, but the principle is true elsewhere. We all have personal spheres, ourselves, our families, our homes, our businesses, etc. No one has more authority to govern in your life than you do. You have the right and the responsibility to do so. Also, no one can lay claim to God's promises or declare His word over your life as effectively as you. You have the right to do this, and no one can take it from you. From this perspective of kingdom authority and spheres, we also get a glimpse into the chaos and turbulence of the times, which continues to accumulate. Jesus, who saw outside the realm of time, foresaw a time of distress and danger when a time of great disorder, uncertainty, and lawlessness would increase with nations and factions rising up against one another. He saw conflicts amassing into a time of trouble and tribulation. This same intensity of the conflicts among nations was seen by Daniel, who possessed the spirit of foresight of the chaos that could be expected before Jesus' return and God's restoration of all things. Then there was the Apostle John, whose vision on the Isle of Patmos revealed insight into the power struggle between good and evil in the final clash. Looking back, the early church was a force to be reckoned with, a movement triggering incredible change. As a whole, the church today is not. As a movement, the early church wielded a supernatural, unstoppable power, a power that operated by a kingdom standard. Today, the church is largely institutionalized, fragmented, and reduced to a moral code, one that the cultures around it seem to overshadow and even despise because of its weakness and the hypocrisy from what they see as the blind leading the blind. Yet, in his glimpse of the time of the end, Daniel perceived the time when a shift would take place. It would be a shift so pronounced as to mark the dividing lines between the righteous and the wicked, between the real and the phony, and between kingdom and religion. According to Scripture, as the end approaches, what awaits the wicked is a time of no peace. Yet among the godly, knowledge is going to increase, and in the midst of the wicked constantly putting more coals on the fire of their ungodly trade, the blind leading the blind would shift into those who are wise, discerning the realities and the differences between the weak, the spiritless, phonies who emulate the world around them, and those who operate with the same spirit as the early church, as spiritual game changers. Daniel did not operate in a culture that accepted watered-down godly values. Instead, he operated in the court of a deadly society that practiced the occult as the standard. Daniel was fearless in the face of this overwhelming opposition. Despite the fearsome risks, he did exploits because he had penetrated the vein or the veil in the realm of the spirit to operate as an ambassador of God's power and prophetic wisdom. Daniel's life exhibited the path of a man of God whose mantle was to operate in the severity of darkness deep within the power structures of the dominant occult pagan society of that day. And in doing so, not only to prevail, but to reset the spiritual atmosphere. This was a very different scenario from the visions of grandeur and distorted perceptions that come from short-sighted, premature successes in the church from the safe havens and alliances with tolerant worldly forces, periodically stamping out little pockets of darkness, which is an unrealistic, short-sighted view held by immature Christians who cling to today's pop Christian, powerless culture. Daniel's moral code was not the pinnacle of his spiritual identity, which religious Christians seem to confuse to be so, but rather it was his courage and means of protection in the midst of the spiritual forces that his life intersected with. The church, the body of Christ, needs courageous leadership, discerning and responding appropriately to the difference between kingdom and religion. That requires courage. It requires unconventional, independent thinking. It understands that progress is limited when achieved through human consent. Courageous leadership operates beyond rubber stamping, collective thinking, or in the need to draw attention to self, but instead is marked by serving. Kingdom-compliant service based on God's ways and guidance. True kingdom-compliant servant leaders will not be duped by the prima donnas, the performers, the glory hounds, the phonies, the prideful, and the fearful, for they miss the mark of courageous leadership. Courageous leadership takes something more. This is where we come to an understanding of the core standard advanced by Jesus, the dividing line between the spiritual and the religious. Jesus came to raise the bar, not create a group of reckless superheroes propelled by their egos bent on self-aggrandizement. The standard Jesus raised is what he refers to as the kingdom, as in the kingdom of God is at hand. Mark 1:15, the kingdom of God is at hand. A great clash is underway in the spiritual realm today. It is a struggle demanding courage in being different, the courage to make a difference in uncompromisingly upholding the kingdom standard, the courage in maintaining an identity as a culture within a culture, of preserving the measures defining true kingdom success, and then in venturing forth from the safe places into the places of risk that reset both the ground rules and the goals. It is the narrow corridor between life and death that defines the way of the kingdom that Jesus came to unveil in preparing a remnant of courageous leaders to obliterate darkness with light. Jesus never came to establish an institution. Instead, he extended a mantle for a movement. It is a mantle of mysteries to be spiritually discerned, but also a mantle of fire for those willing to pay the cost to bring about change in this unfolding, intensifying drama of our age. In the kingdom, courageous leadership is where the fire falls. It is where the power lies. It is a mantle that operates according to a different standard, which includes kingdom authority within your sphere of assignment. Advance the kingdom of heaven on earth within your calling and sphere of assignment as a courageous leader, a commissioned kingdom-compliant servant leader. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 through 3, the Apostle Paul says, I, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long-suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. In that context lies your mantle of kingdom authority within your sphere of assignment. If you would like to refer this episode to others, click on share. And subscribe to the YouTube channel to stay up to date when new episodes drop. Thanks for joining me. I'm glad you did. I hope you join me next time for Kingdom Compliance with Dr. James Bruton, where we stay tuned in to the frequency of heaven.